There he is,
Rory Kramer.
Dude, that's an amazing intro. I love that.
How are you? Thank you.
I'm good. I'm excited to be here today with you.
The godfather of the creator space.
Oh, gosh.
I have been waiting for this day for so long. Matter of fact, I was sharpening my arsenal of skills just to make sure I was prepared for this interview.
I'm glad to hear that because your arsenal of skills is something that that amazes me.
Really?
So, yeah. I mean, you've always…
I don't have many skills.
Well, the few that you have, like, they're very sharpened.
Oh, thank you.
But no, like, I see you. You're the kind of person to me that you stand out in a crowd and, like, anything that you do, you leave an impression. You know how to make people laugh and you pay attention to detail. So, like, I'm always curious, like, if you're going to be involved… I love seeing what happens.
Thank you, Rory. I feel the same about you. I think one of the crazy things about our friendship, for those who don't know, Rory and I have become friends probably over the last 2 years. After the first few times I met him, didn't even give me the time of day. But I didn't earn it. I didn't earn it. But now we're good buddies. And I think what I find interesting is we have very different backgrounds. Mm-hmm. And we're very different people. But we still have a lot of the same core values. And I think that's why we get along so well. So what you were just saying right there, like, you make me laugh, you make me smile. No homo, but like, I feel the same about you.
Yeah, yeah.
And when I saw your Lake Life video a few years ago when I initially reached out to you, I got all these emotions because it was an experience of like an extended family. Craziness on the lake, the older brothers that I never had. And so, like, even just watching your videos in those early days, I had, like, this emotional feeling that I had never felt, that I had yearned for, like, as a kid. And so, take me back to those days, like, growing up in Indiana. And tell me a little bit about your background.
Growing up in Indiana, like, small town, southern Indiana called Tell City. Mm. Not a lot to do. It's very farm and, I guess, boring. And so for me, it was, I idolized my two older brothers, had an older sister. And so I was always playing the game of, like, how to get their attention because they were so much older than me. And as I got older, that's when I found, like, a video camera and the fact that you could record a moment, play it back. And, like, that was how I was able to finally capture my brother's time and my sister's time.
Do you think today that conditioning has influenced how you are? Because I still see you as the person who's, like, the center of attention everywhere you go. And you're so good at it, whether it be, like, your impressions, cracking jokes, playing pranks on people. You still have this way of, like, attracting all this attention to you. Do you think that stemmed from having to do that as a kid?
Absolutely. I think a lot of it's just the people you grow up with, the people you surround yourself with, the how you grew up. Like, growing up, my mom, like, always encouraged me to, like, use my imagination. And I think that, like, when I hung out with, like, one of my best friends, like, you know, we had, like, imaginary worlds. We had imaginary friends. And it was kind of like there was it all. I've been thinking about that a lot, actually, lately. It's just when you're a kid, like, how are you able to think so freely and be able to create these, like an imaginary friend? Like,
right.
How do you learn something like that? And, like, how do you forget it as you get older? And not saying you still have to have imaginary friends when you get older, but, like, that way of thinking, like, how does that sometimes
disappear?
How does that disappear?
I think about that a lot too, because I think imagination is the root of creativity. Mm-hmm. In order to be creative, you must think about something that has not been done. You have to think outside the box. And I think through school and through life, like, even Rory was Santa Claus for us, like, 2 years ago. So I knew he was a good friend. I was like, day before, Rory, I need you to show up in a Santa costume. No hesitation. He's like, I got you. But Santa's an imaginative thing, but you hit an age where they're like, that's not real. And so you're almost taught to not believe in
what is not real.
Yeah.
And that's kind of what being a creative is. You have to create something that doesn't yet exist.
Yeah. It's funny you say that doesn't yet exist, because I just heard this sermon at church, and they were talking about the book of Ecclesiastes and how they were saying everything that's like all the stress that you're holding on to of just like, oh, I need to do this, I need to do that. Like everything, like what's like, why it doesn't matter, because it's already been done before, and everything that you're trying to do will be done again and will be forgotten. And so it's just kind of like about letting go and just regardless of it being perfect or having this idea of what it should be, of just doing it. And so that, I don't know, that kind of stood out to me as like kind of true in a sense of like, why do you get so caught up in the what ifs and like that in between state of rather than just like, hey, here's something I want to go do and going to do it rather than putting it off, procrastinating because it's not good enough for this or it's not good enough for that.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Talk about the shift going from shooting video as a kid, trying to get attention from your brothers and sisters. The world wasn't saying it. Now you're being critiqued by the world through social media, by brands. What is that like when something goes from love and hobby to this is my identity?
Man, it's weird. It's, I spent a lot of the last year just kind of like reflecting on that and like looking at it. And it's crazy to think that what was something that used to be such an escape for me and such a place of this is my own place to escape and nobody can touch me there. Not in a sense of like, you can't do what I do, but it was like, this was my safe zone. Like, and whatever I created was, it allowed me to just overcome certain feelings or push past my own comfort zone. Mm. And now to have a thing of like, where you're still trying to do that and to have people or brands like tell you, this is wrong or this is right. And it's just like, it's hard to not listen to that.
Right.
It's hard to not shut that off.
And how have you coped with that? Like putting up a video that you might love, but maybe it doesn't get as many likes. Is it hard to separate from what we're now critiquing ourselves by?
I mean, it's. I think everybody goes through that phase of like comparison. I mean, it's hard not to. So what I've tried to do with everything I put out is to remember at the core of it why I do it and why of just like past successes of that. It doesn't matter if, you know, a million people see it. It doesn't matter if everybody hates it, everybody likes it, whatever. If, you know, if it can resonate with one person and it can have some sort of impact on their trajectory in life or you know, change it, then like you've succeeded, you know, beyond expectation.
Right. What you did for me, the lake life video, I never grew up around a lake. I never grew up. The only thing I was flipping was burgers on the grill. I wasn't. And I saw that video, the camaraderie, the family, the brotherhood, the craziness, riding off bikes, off ramps into the water. And that inspired me. And so that was cool because I know you started making those videos out of love. You didn't care if anybody saw them.
Yeah, I don't know what it is in the Midwest. I don't know if it's just like the hillbilliness in people. It's just like how you come up with these ideas. Mm. You know, bike ramp at the end of a dock. Right. It's just it seems to be like in the people's blood in that part of the world. But I don't know.
Were you somewhat of an outlier because entertainment is known for being like in Los Angeles and New York?
What would be an outlier be?
Someone who was a lone wolf in the film or entertainment space. You were.
Yeah. I mean, the only people that were really in creatives were if you're in a band or if you're a skateboarder. Because if you skateboarded, pretty much everybody was a filmer too, because they if you were skating, they would film you and vice versa. So, yeah, like I was pretty much the only, one of the only few creatives in my town, so to say.
Yeah.
Which is, it's weird because then a lot of people that don't understand it have their own opinion of it. It's just, you know, when are you going to get a real mm-hmm. job? And for me, in like video, I was ahead of the time. Like the social platforms hadn't presented themselves. So jobs that I wish existed could exist.
Right.
So when I was like 25, the only kind of jobs you could really get were in some sort of like TV station, news, sporting events, like traveling with bands and DJs or shooting for brands the way it is now didn't exist. Like
right.
5-6 years ago.
Right.
And now it's, anybody can do that. Anybody's capable of self-educating themselves on YouTube, Google. It's amazing. You can save money. You can test out career paths without the repercussions of going to a college and necessarily putting $80,000 into debt, $100,000 into debt, where you can try something out. Like what you put in, you get out, that old saying. So like if you go on to YouTube or Google for a certain amount of time, like months, whatever, and teach yourself, you try, you get some jobs, see, okay, maybe it's not for me. At least you don't have that wasted time or put yourself in a hole of like, now I'm in debt.
Right.
I think it's pretty fascinating. And it's, right.
Or spend your 20s and early 30s trying to work your way up a ladder when you're working for a production company or an agency, you probably don't get to have the creative freedom that you did.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. It's, I don't know. It's just, yeah, what you're saying, you don't get the creative freedom that way. And just the way I've been lucky to have my career path go, just having that freedom of creativity has been such a huge thing for me.
Because your style is very unorthodox.
Yeah.
Innovative, but unorthodox.
I think it just stems from like what I, just how you're raised and what you watched back then. Mm. I grew up on movies like Top Gun, Dumb and Dumber, like Scorsese, Tarantino films. And then my short content that I consumed was just music videos and Nickelodeon. Mm. And so I think a lot of just that, those kind of genres just played a part into how I create.
And Jackass played a big role in your career, am I right?
Yep. I remember freshman in high school, like that was one of the first times it was just like, wow, like my friends and I were already skating and just already getting hurt and doing like just doing some sort of antics.
Right.
And then when you saw people on TV, like not necessarily becoming a celebrity, but like making it a career.
Right.
And it was like the first time like I really saw light at the end of the tunnel. Cause I wanted to be in a band at first and it was just, I don't think that was ever gonna happen. But then like whenever I started getting into video and I saw these other people doing similar things and having success with it, I was like, it's a possibility. Like there's this new wave of, I didn't know what it was there because it hadn't been really done before.
It was raw.
Yeah.
And it was just a bunch of guys messing around. I remember that first hike we went on. I hadn't really like talked to you. I see you out, but I hadn't had like a good conversation with you.
That was an early morning.
I forget where. Oh, you know what? I went cliff diving, but we still didn't really like talk.
I
had a meetup that I was like, I went with Taylor Offer.
Yep.
And I think you text me or said something to me. You're like, hey, like we should hang out.
Yeah, yeah.
And so I was like, all right, I'll pick you up at sunrise. We'll do a hike. Let's see if this guy's for real or if it's all show. And you're like, all right. And you were on a torn ACL. So we hobble up the backside of Runyon Canyon. You're limping, dragging one leg. And one of the things you were talking about, Hazel, when you started shooting, you kind of taught yourself everything. But you also would use camera settings or do
things a different way, and people would be like, hey, that's not how you're supposed to do that. And you'd be like, oh, that's how I want to do it. Is that, can you attribute some of that to some of your style? And like, how, what are some examples of that for like those who are creatives out there?
It was just kind of like, I grew up shooting on like actual like camcorders. So it was a different kind of way of, with DSLRs and like the aperture ISO, like shutter speed. The other one was just kind of like, I don't know, it was a different kind of camera. And so whenever I got a DSLR, like I just started cranking the shutter speed and people would be like, oh, the shutter speed's supposed to be double the frame rate. And I'm like, I don't, like, it looks good in camera. Like, this is what I like. And they're like, well, this is wrong. And I'm like, who says that that's the way it has to be? I go, the image is still recording. Like, I don't get what you're really trying to say here. I was like, it's against the law to speed, but like, you're doing it anyways. So for me, it was just like, I liked shooting in that because I found that it made the image more sporadic and it had more high energy. So it catered to the way that I like to shoot. And it gave off the things that I was shooting, I think to me it allowed it to stand out more.
Right.
And that was just because I used the camera the way I thought it should be used versus like, here's how you're supposed to use it. Here's the correct way. And I'm not saying I'm the first person to ever do that, but like to me it was just, you know, figuring it out for yourself, figuring out a style and kind of like what you're asking, like how did that, what were you saying, attribute?
Yeah, like how has that attributed, like you kind of going against the grain to you breaking through?
Like when I started doing these lyric videos, I never liked like doing graphics just because it was so time consuming to do all these lyric, like each word for the lyric video. Mm-hmm. And I didn't like just the cop out of like just putting the text on the bottom, almost like subtitles. And I just found a workaround. I found using my own handwriting and I found a way to film it with the DSLR that gave it kind of like it was going to the beat of the music. Mm. And I'd film it, like play the song, film it. And then in post, I would mask out the background. And for me, that was the way I knew how to make it look cool versus like, I didn't know how to animate to make it look cool. And then when people saw that, they were just like, there was a whole bunch of tutorials on YouTube of like dissecting how I did it. And like they all had it about 95% right. Like one would have something that this one didn't have and this one would have something that this didn't have. But it was my first, like seeing that was like, wow, here's something that I was actually really not skilled in. I was weak in my graphics and like animation. But because I was weak, finding a creative way around it actually allowed me to tap in and break into this new realm that kind of hadn't been done yet.
Right.
And for me, it was just kind of like, hey, like it just proved that just because you feel like you might not be the smartest or the best doesn't mean that you still can't have success or do stuff that's groundbreaking.
Right.
Just because Blake's doing everything this way and let's say you're the most successful at the time, hey, like, there's a reason you're successful and there's a reason that you shouldn't be doing stuff exactly like you because there's all these other paths that you can break into.
I wouldn't follow my footsteps. I'm just kidding.
Nah.
No, hopefully, I leave a legacy where you should, but I totally get what you're saying. And I think that was a closer video, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Another story that reminds me of this is how you take negatives and you turn into positive. You were telling me this story about the Paris video.
Yeah.
And how you, did you have a computer hard drive that crashed? Do you want to tell us that story?
So I went to Tulum with Alexis Rin. We just met each other. We quickly became friends. We went there for like 2 or 3 days and we just shot a bunch of just stuff. Like, I was like, what do you want me to shoot? And like, we just kind of like talked about it. We just shot some stuff. And when we were leaving, I was like, she's like, hey, can I like help you pick out music? And I was like, yo, I kind of have this feeling I can make this into this lyric video for my friends. And I was like, would you be open to that? She's like, yeah, of course. So I was like, let me work on something. If it doesn't work, then I'll hit you up about music. So I cut together this whole thing on a plane, and I'm like, yo, this. I get to the Cayman Islands for Christmas with my family, and I get to where we're staying. I open the laptop because I'm like, yo, like I gotta like do the lyrics now. Gotta send it to Chainsmokers, see what they think. And I get the folder. I've never seen the folder. I'd only heard about it from Drew. It's this folder with a slash through it. And as soon as I saw that, I remember it clear as day, his story with the folder with the line through it, where he lost Don't Let Me Down and he lost Setting Fires, where he had to recreate those songs from scratch because he didn't back up the hard drive, send it off to a place, they couldn't recover it. And so like I'm like, great, if they couldn't recover a song, they're not going to recover my video. And I ended up not getting it back. I fly back to LA for one day to shoot Chainsmokers at the convention center. And I have this like low res version of it on my phone. I show it to Drew and he's like, yeah, this is sick. And like, but you don't have like, you don't have the footage anymore. Like, what are we going to do with a low res version? I'm just like, I got it. And I remembered when I, luckily once in my career, Scooter Braun asked me to shoot for Kanye West. And in the night I got to shoot with him, like I had to go show him some of my videos to like make sure I was qualified to shoot. And he's looking at all this stuff and he's like, yo, this is all dope. He's like, this is like super on point. Like, but my work was too polished. He didn't like that it was, I guess like kind of predictable where he was just like, oh, this transition goes into this and this, like, wow. He's like, I'm into that raw look, that VHS look. And I was just like, okay. So I was like, everything I know at this point, I threw it out the window. I took one camera body and one lens and I was like, I'm gonna make it work. And it kind of went back to that thing of what my settings were, we were talking about earlier. Right. I was just like, I'm gonna shoot it. There's a ton of grain. He likes that raw look, that VHS look. And so I ended up remembering that conversation and I applied it to this video where I was like, if I distress it and put this VHS filter on there and I export it and I upscale it on the export, I was like, nobody's going to notice the difference because it's going to deteriorate the quality with that filter on there. Sure enough, you know, you couldn't tell a difference and got it approved. Everybody was like, this is sick. Yeah. Like, the VHS look is awesome. And like, that was a genius. And I'm like, it was an accident. So it was just like one of those like, here's what life gave you. How do you take the problem? How do you fix it? And not let it, you know, kill what could be.
Right. I think creativity is really just problem solving.
Mm-hmm.
You have a problem, come up with a solution. And after that, VHS video and film took off, became a trend.
That was, it was a huge.
You started
trend.
Carrying around a big camera.
Oh, yeah. I'm here at Coachella.
Yeah.
That was, I'm trying to like, I'm just now thinking about like carrying around that camera. But like, those were the cameras I started on.
Right.
And like, trying to remember back to when all my friends in high school would come over after school and we'd go to my parents' like the attic, we'd lock ourselves up there with a computer and you'd plug in the camera, rewind the tape, play it back. But like now it's such a process and it's so like, this takes forever. But back then it was so fun and it took forever. Right. And now it's just, we're in that world of like, I want it now. Yeah. So it's interesting.
Yeah. And we'll get back to like the story, because I think what you do now with your friends, you become great friends with pretty much everybody you work with, is a carbon copy of what you were doing as a kid with your friends, just for money and obviously on a much bigger stage.
Yeah.
But I want to take a step back. So you end up as a student of IU, right?
Yep.
To Indiana. And that's where you really decided, like, I'm going to put in work and figuring out how to edit, right?
More high school is where I taught myself.
High school.
Yeah. And then, like, when I was going to college, like, that's when I knew, like, different programs existed. And, like, where you're saying, like, with Jackass, like, I found out like Bam Margera like shot and edited a lot of the content that he put out. And so I found out like programs he was using, and like I'd go to computer labs in college that had those programs, and I would just sit there for 8 hours a day and teach myself like that language, that program. And then by the time I got in the classes that allowed you to use those programs, I was way ahead of everybody else. And when I started making edits for the projects that were due in class, mine stood out because I'd already had so much, I was so familiar with the program. Not super familiar, but more familiar than everybody else. And people would be like, yo, like, this is sick. How'd you do this? And I was just like, it was kind of like when I first did video or found a way to capture my brothers and sisters' attention. Mm. It was like I had that again, where it was like, oh, I put in the time to do something and now people want to see it.
Talk to me about putting in the time, because you got started at a young age. And I think a lot of people get started now and expect it to happen overnight. And as you said earlier, you compare yourself to everybody. So kids looking up to Rory Kramer, they don't see the climb. They didn't see the 15 years of work that it took you. Actually, more than 15 years, just to get you where you're at today. So what advice could you give to those who are just getting started on just staying patient and putting in the work?
I mean, what's like, I don't get what the big deal of making it is if it's something that you love doing. Because it's just like, if you love doing it, then the rest of your life should be dedicated to that. And there shouldn't be such a rush. You know, it's a marathon, not a sprint, that saying. What is making it? Why do you really want to make it? Is it really going to like cure all your problems or like this or that? But I think it's just doing the time and like enjoying all aspects of it. And if you can't do that, then shouldn't be doing it.
And coming from the guy who I call the godfather of this whole creator space, who's worked with Bieber, Chainsmokers, Kanye, Ray Schremmerd.
So what can you say about like those who are just wanting it to be on that stage? You know what I'm saying? Like what do you find the most fulfillment in?
What I found the most fulfillment in was like what the video did to somebody that watched it. I've seen messages of like, hey, I wanted to kill myself and now like I have a different outlook on life, or like you saved my life. Like knowing that like you can do something in your bedroom and you had no intention of the video doing that to somebody, that's like that's crazier than any place that I've been in the world, any amount of money I've gotten paid. Like that just baffles me that something that I'm trying to do to resonate within myself can impact and change somebody's life completely. And also just being able to create something for an artist and have them come say something like,
the world's never seen me like this before.
I remember when Bieber had came to my parents' lake house, he had saw lake life, he wanted to come experience it. And I put together this like 45 second little clip, and he was just like, yo, we gotta go get Scooter. We gotta go share everybody. He's like, and when they're watching, he's like, yo, nobody's ever seen me like this. Like, and it was just like, wow, what? Like, it just broke your heart. Like, here's his, yes, he's Justin Bieber. Yes, he's super famous, can sing. But like, at the end of the day, he's a human being. He's out on this earth trying to figure it out like everybody else. Right. And so it's crazy that like, I've like, something that I create had those two effects without my intentions.
Right. And I think that's why guys like Justin, Drew, Alex love being around you, because you get to a point where they're at and it's hard to live a real life. And I think you bring them back to the grounding that is real life, just because you're so fun and outgoing. You talked a little bit about Justin's rituals, like get off stage and he's got over 100,000 people worshiping him. Mm-hmm. And you talked about like what he does after that, or what he does to like
be able to perform night after night, I mean, I'm sure that's like an adrenaline rush that none of us have ever experienced.
Yeah, like I just remember one time, like when I was on tour with him, he was in this routine of as soon as he came off the stage, he'd get a bucket of ice water dumped on him because it would just shock his body. It would, because the water's so cold, like anybody, like you get in a cold shower, it just like, oh, nobody wants that, but it brings you to center. Like it makes you realize, ah, this is freezing. So you just are on stage where you have all these people chanting your name. Like that's building you up, to putting you on a pedestal. It's like stroking your ego. And to just reset like that, now you can come off stage. You can easily, you're not as amped up. So if you want to go to bed, you can go to bed. So it brings you to a place of just more center.
Yeah.
And like that, just witnessing something like that has just made me remember to do that.
Right.
Like if you're in the shower, like before I'm getting out, just keep it on cold for a second and it just jolts you. Yeah. And
I love the cold showers.
Yeah.
And it's crazy because I'll get flustered if there's like traffic on the 405, let alone like half the shit that they're probably putting up with everywhere they go. Like you talked about the Iceland trip where you're finally in a place where there was like nobody out there, and then somebody like starts taking pictures of him and he's like, please don't ruin this for me.
Yeah, like that was crazy. Like he literally was just like, yo, pull the van over, and hops out, and this guy's like hopping out and getting his camera and just like putting it together. And he's just like, yo, he goes, I know what you want. You want some photos of me? I'm in your country. Like, I just want to see, like, if you take photos and, you know, sell them, everybody's going to know I'm here. He goes, I'll let you take some photos if you promise you won't sell them for like 2 days. Shakes hands, gives him lets him take some photos. Sure enough, we go enjoy the rest of our trip. We have some just a great time. And then as we leave, the guy sells the photos, they go up. And it was just like, it was one of those cool experiences of like, just respect being shown both ways.
That's amazing. And you fought Justin Bieber once.
Twice? Yep.
I know one of the times.
Well, like one of them I didn't post online. The other one, like,
That was the boxing one?
Yeah, so two boxing matches. One, like we're in New York. He was working on purpose. And like, he'd always just like love to wrestle around the studio. And I said something like, dude, I would whoop your ass. And he's just like, I knew how to get him just riled up. And so like, I've never thrown a punch in my life. So like, I'm just blowing smoke up his ass. And he's just like, Mikey, call the gym. Like, let's go. And I'm like, oh crap,
he's really competitive, huh?
So I'm just like, my only hope is just running my mouth.
Right.
Like maybe I can get in his head. No, like this guy's like, he's naturally good at everything he does. His footwork, he's so quick. I'm over there throwing haymakers, just praying one lands. Like
going in.
And he's literally just like, he worked me. But it was one of those things that was like, I'd never been in the, like just head to head with anybody. And it's like, you learn a lot about yourself and a lot about,
Yeah. Another time was for real?
Well, no. Another time was same scenario. We were like on a plane flying home, and it was like, as soon as we landed in Burbank, we went straight to the gym. And it was one of those things. Now we're in a smaller gym where I still don't know what I'm doing. And everybody stopped in the gym and they're around the ring watching. I'm like, don't you guys have shit to do? Like, stop watching. I'm about to get my ass whooped.
That's what you get for running your mouth, man.
I know.
We should go to boxing together.
No, you would destroy me.
We'll go like shadow box and then we'll move to the ring. I wouldn't want to hit you though.
I know.
Even though I'm competitive, unless you were running your mouth, then I don't know. Things could get a little testy. I want to take you back because like there's a video that I know is special to you that gives me chills every time I watch it. And I'm going to play the song. We're going to run through the song. But then I want you to tell me what this song and this video makes you feel. I'm not going to tell you until I play it.
I thought you were going to bring up my acting reel video.
We're going to get to that too.
When I was 16, my father said, you can do anything you want with your life. You just have to be willing to work hard to get it. That's when I decided when I die, I want to be remembered for the life I lived, not the money I made.
Once upon a younger year, when all our shadows disappeared, the animals inside came out to play. Went face to face with all our fears, learned our lessons through the tears, made memories we knew would never fade. One day my father, he told me, son, don't let it slip away. He took me in his arms, I heard him say, when you get older, your wild heart will live for younger days. Think of me if ever you're afraid. He said one day you'll leave this world behind, so live a life you will remember. My father told me when I was just a child, these are the nights to never die. My father told me,
start this video. So this is Avicii, The Nights.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know the full story behind you making this video, which I want to hear, but the line you used to start this video, I want to be remembered for the life I lived, not the money I made. Fast forward 5 years later now, obviously we lose Avicii tragically. You're on top of the world, probably accomplished more than you could ever imagine. What does that line now mean to you and that video with your dad?
Man, it's like, that's like that video and like everything that happened with it was just like one of those things of just like the universe lining up for you. And like, why me? How did this happen? And like now looking, like just what if this song had came a few years later? Like now we know like what had happened to him. And like, it's just, I was very fortunate for that time in life to have happened, knowing that his time here was so short. And like, I don't know, it was like this song was just written for how I was living my life at the time and like what I was wanting to strive to do, regardless of having a 9-to-5 job. And like on the weekends and in my free time, I was trying to live it up as much as I could because I wasn't passionate about my job. So any free chance I got to adventure, be with friends, like that was what, as soon as Friday hit at my job, I like a lot of the times I'd go down to San Diego and go cliff jumping and stay all weekend with my friends down there. And it was just like, that was life to me. And I lived for those moments. And like, I knew I had to have a job to pay rent and do this other stuff. But it was just like, if there was another world you could live in where money didn't exist, I wanted to live there. Yeah. Like, cause money, I felt like it just took so much of your time because you had to make it because you had to pay rent. And I get it, but I just didn't want to be defined for that part of my life. I wanted to be defined for laughing with my friends. I wanted to be defined for being a fun uncle or, you know, doing stuff that I enjoyed, not the time where I felt like life, this is how life got set up. Here's the rules that you have to play by in order, like, go to college, do all this. I didn't want to be defined by that. And now getting, like what you're saying, 5 years later, like, looking at all that, even more so. Like, that quote sticks out even more because now I've had 5 years of success and I'm a lot more well-known, a lot more reputable than I was before that video. And now bigger offers are coming in and a lot of jobs where it's just like, dang, like, I could do this job. But it's like, you see yourself wanting to take the job because of the paycheck, where it's just like, that's a clear indicator for me that I need to say no, because I know it's not, I'm not doing it for the right reasons.
Yeah, I think that's tough because the money starts to get so good when you're on your level. And at those early stages, you're pretty much doing it for free. I'm curious. So you were in LA. You had moved to LA at that point.
Mm-hmm.
You came out to LA to act, right? Was that?
Yeah. Yeah. Because like video, like I was saying earlier, it didn't have like the social platforms right. that it has now. It didn't have the outlets. It was kind of like YouTube. And I'd made YouTube videos and like for consistently, like for a few years, nothing crazy had ever popped off. And I think my most successful video was my friend and I drinking, having some beers at a sunset in LA. And the only reason it did well was because of the Mickey Avalon song that I used, because it was in The Hangover.
Growth hack.
Yeah. And so it had nothing to do with my video making right. skills. And I don't know where I was going.
Yeah.
With
so you were.
So I moved out here to act and right. like, because I love being in videos. And 5 years goes by working a 9-to-5. And
I kind here. Of,
yeah, now I'm here.
Yeah. So at that early stage when you weren't making money making videos, you were just having fun doing what you loved on the side of work. How did you get noticed by an Avicii? Like, how did that video opportunity even come about?
So around the time of my 30th birthday, I helped shoot second angle on this Corella music video because I knew their manager.
Mm.
So I kind of was making my way in that way in the industry. And this DJ Blau had saw this. His manager had saw my video I'd made with a couple buddies from college for IU. They wrote a song for the football team and I filmed a video for it. And one of the guys that was that wrote the song, his buddy was managing Blau. So he saw it on his Facebook. So wow. I started coming in the industry as a like touring videographer. So I kind of had two different ways in. And then one night I just get a random email from this guy that's named Nick Furlong that's singing on the nights that wrote it with Tim. And they had no idea that I was working with Corella or Blau. And so it was kind of like three different ways I was coming into the scene. But the Avicii one, like, that was like, it didn't seem real. Right. I felt like somebody
was on top.
I thought somebody was messing with me. I was just like, there's,
yeah
right. This is too, it's like anybody that's trying to get a break in life or like that's working towards something, it just seemed too good to be true. I was like, this isn't, there's no way. And my like everybody, like once it was getting like close to the finish line, they were just like, yo, Rory's doing an Avicii video. I'm like, shut up. Like, no, like I don't, like until it's on his page, right. like I'm not going to believe that. And when it came out, it was just like, it hit 10 million views like real quick. And my dad called me and he was just like, yo, like give a video 10 million views. And I'm like, we have a video of 10 million
Your
views.
Your dad
like,
is like, the star of the yeah. video, yeah.
That was probably the coolest part, was to be able to make something, you know, about my life with like real clips.
Mm-hmm.
But to like be able to place like my dad as like kind of like the whole storyline. Mm-hmm. And like now that he's like going through cancer, like just to have like so many people like that follow me, like yeah. kind of know who he is already.
Right.
Like without me just saying, oh, and my dad is going through like cancer now. Like people already knew him and already like respected him because he was the one that gave me this advice when I was 16. Like he was the backbone of the whole Avicii video. So like people were like, when they found out he was getting sick, like now people ask about him. People like see him as some sort of like strong figure.
My father, that song, when I heard that song, I get the chills. And then when I saw that video, just like the father-son relationship, knowing that, you know, it's not going to last. Like, you know, one day, like our parents won't be here. And that video just makes you feel this emotion and this connection to your dad. And I'm curious, how is your dad doing?
He's good. He's, his tumors have like stabled for the most part for like, but like they're starting to grow again. But from where he was a few years ago is night and day different. So he's a lot more active right now. And, so he's good. Mm. He just got done riding his horse across Michigan. Guy owns a horse. Yeah. I mean, I'm like, you're like basically
not stopping him.
Yeah. And I think that I think a lot of his like success with that, or just being able to outrun it, or whatever, however you want to put it, has a lot to do with his mentality. And he's just kind of like, I got it. Okay. I've accepted it. Like, I'm not going to sit here and dwell on it. Like, he's back to playing tennis with mom. He's back to riding bikes, back to basically, he's always had this quote, like, idle hands are the devil's workshop. So he's always tinkering with something, whether he's blowing the driveway off, whether he's out, you know, putting a new rope on the ski handle. He's always doing something. And I've just noticed that he's very good at like keeping his mind busy and like focused on something.
I've actually heard a lot recently, there's no like scientific backing, but when you continue your life with a positive mindset and you don't become a victim of cancer, oftentimes those are the people who beat it. Not 100% of the time, but I remember you were telling me like, yeah, my dad, he's still doing everything the same. He's active. And obviously I'm not there at home with you, but I think that's like why he's going to continue to defeat this thing, because he doesn't seem like the type of guy who's just going to say like, oh, I have cancer. Like, I'm just going to lay in bed and that's the end.
He's always viewed it like quality of life quality of life over quantity of life. Like, ever since he got it, where he's just like, I think he's just really focused on those moments and time that he's had with family and like grandkids that's helped him out. He's going to be 69 next week. So, yeah.
I met him at your Dare to Live
premiere
along with your mom.
Yep.
I feel like I've met your mom again somewhere. But awesome parents, man. You're super close with them, right?
Yeah, they're awesome. And like to be able to like do a TV show and be able to have them like be a part of it, it's cool, because my mom's how I got into video. Like if it wasn't for her bringing a VHS camera and her like film, like little point and shoot film camera everywhere, like my whole childhood, my whole life is documented. And like, so she was infatuated with taking photos and film. Mm. And so whenever I got into it, like it was just basically waiting for me to pick it up.
You almost always have that little camera with you for memories, which I love.
Yeah.
You won't see most of those pictures on social media. Some of them may be. But I always was fascinated by being able to capture memories too. I don't do it nearly as good as you.
Who's to say what's good and what's not?
It's the best though. Like looking back at those memories when you're a kid, or even over the last few years for everything you've accomplished, which I want to jump into, because your trajectory of your career since that video skyrockets. And a lot of people are like, how did Rory get in all these circles? How did he make a name for himself? And I'm curious, like, what you think made you the go-to guy for Drew and Alex, the Chainsmokers. And I also want to hear the story, the first time you toured with them. Like, you guys didn't really know each other at this point. They go to bed. You don't. What happens?
Which time? No.
You know what I'm talking
about. Yeah, I know what you're talking about. So I go on this bus tour called Recess, and we meet each other for the first time. And after that week of, they asked me to stay on their bus, they're like, yo, we're going to Asia. We got this song, Roses, coming out. The record label doesn't think it's a hit. They think it'll do well with our core fans, but like, we really believe in it. He sends me this song and I'm like, yo, this is fucking sick. And so I was like, yeah, I'm in. So I'd never been to Asia. So we go to Asia for a week, and it's like, it couldn't be better. The first day is my birthday, and I'm just like, it's going to Japan. Like, there's this new song that's coming out. I'm making a video to it. It's my birthday. And Alex is like, yo, why am I getting so many like tweets about coming with you to Japan? Like, wait, what?
Who are you?
And I was like, Avicii's big in Japan, dude. Like, and they were like, so everywhere we went, he'd be checking in. He'd be like, yo, so like, this guy's in the new Avicii video. And like, just trying to embarrass me. And I'm just like, dude, he would pull it up and show the people.
Alex isn't recognized as widely as he is today, for sure, right?
No, like back then, like nobody knew like who they were. Well, they knew, like a lot of people in Japan knew them because of Selfie, but like they weren't recognizable. Right. And so every night they would play Avicii the Nights, and Alex would be like, I'm playing the song, and you're like, I'm taking your camera. So it became this thing where I was just like, all right, like here's my chance to be that rock star front man. And we're in Jakarta, and I just took off for the front row. And I just start climbing the scaffolding about like 25 feet up. And I'm just like,
you were ready.
And Drew is just like, yo, I've never been so jealous of somebody in my life. And I was like, it's like, well, that was probably my only chance to do something like that. So I took it. That was not what you even asked about. You asked about the one night.
The story, you're getting to it.
Yeah, so we're so we're in Malaysia.
This is good storytelling.
And that they do that again. They play the song and I go do my thing. And as the night ends, like I'm like just kind of like that Bieber thing. So much adrenaline. Mm. I didn't do like nobody dumped the ice bucket on me. So like I'm amped up from like these guys like playing the song, all these fans knowing who I am, like people wanting pictures with me. So I'm like, could walk on water at this point. I'm just like in my room doing a recap, tweeting with this kid that's like, yo, can't believe like I met you. And I'm like, yo, what's up? Cool. And he's like, got to check out the Bat Caves. I'm like, what are the Bat Caves? Back to editing the recap. Oh, here's a video of Steve Aoki at the Bat Caves. I'm start watching it, keep editing the recap. And I'm like, yo, this is sick. And I was like, oh, I'd love to go, but I don't have a car. And he's just like, I can pick you up. And I'm like, cool, you pick me up, I'll go. Back to editing the recap. And all of a sudden, the next thing I know, I'm outside the hotel getting in this car with a stranger. I don't have service that's only have Wi-Fi. Once I go off the Wi-Fi, you know, it's all trust in this kid. Like, hopefully he's not going to kill me. So I go have the best experience of my life. And it's 7 in the morning. I get back. Like,
did you like find like monkeys?
Yeah, there's monkeys. We're in Malaysia. So we climb these like hundreds of stairs up into this bat cave. This like temple's there. And it was just mind-blowing. And it was all just because like I said like, fuck it. Like, I'm just going to go with this kid. And so I get back to the hotel and Alex and Drew are like…
You post on Snapchat?
Yeah. I start posting like all everything to like Instagram and Snapchat and Twitter. And they're like, where did you go? And they're like, and I'm like, I thought about calling you. And they're like, dude, that looks so sick. And they were, I don't know. It was just one of those crazy stories that was just like, I don't know if I'm ever going to get another chance like this again. Like,
you're just doing you.
I just took advantage of where I was in the world and just never having had that kind of opportunity before. Where it's just like, I'm tired as shit right now. I'm still a little drunk. I should probably go to bed. But I was just like, screw it. I'm here. And I couldn't believe I was in like that position to be able to even go see something like that.
And most people in your shoes now would probably be pretty nervous. And it sounds like you were almost ready for that moment. And then that night, you didn't really do it for show. You're like, I might as well enjoy it while I'm here. I just flew all the way to Asia.
Yeah.
But I think that's probably part of why everyone loves working with you, right? Is because you're not looking at them as like stars. You're looking at them as friends and people you can just go have a good time with.
Yeah. It's just, I just find myself relating to them in the sense of being a creative, being that appreciates my work and I appreciate theirs. And I've never really, it's nice to have like a rapport with somebody that you find yourself not only being able to share ideas with and they can help fuel them, but to just have relationships and knowing how to give them something that they might necessarily haven't been given before. Mm. Like with Bieber, I found myself more often than not bringing my camera and just having a conversation and being able to read his energy and seeing like when he was like excited to be somewhere and wanted like, oh, he's gonna want the camera now. Or if, you know, he's just wanting to decompress where I'm just kind of like leave the camera and he's like, wait, where's your camera? And I'm just like, oh, we're just hanging. And he's just like, wait, what? Right. This hasn't happened before. So it was just learning to not only be treated as a job, but treat it as, I don't know, like you're spending so much time with these people. Like, why wouldn't you want to get to know them and get to, it helps you tell the story too. It's kind of like doing research and understanding where they come from and be able to tell who they really are versus what the media tries to portray or what people think of them. Like, I remember when I first worked with Bieber, like a lot of people on my socials hated me because they called me a sellout. And I'd always been a fan of his since like he came on the scene. I thought he was very talented, could sing, could dance. He was all package. Might not have been a like huge fan of the actual music, but I was a fan of his talents. And just as he got older, like, you know, I felt like it wasn't fair that he had like, I don't know, just anybody growing up in that kind of like that limelight.
Right. Grew up famous.
Yeah, it's a weird thing. It's like Macaulay Culkin too. Like, you know, they don't know. Like, you can't predict what's going to happen or what that's going to do to you. So.
Yeah, that's got to be crazy. Obviously, I grew up as not famous as possible. But I can only imagine. And now like everyone's like, oh, I wish I was Bieber. I wish I was the Chainsmokers. But those guys are probably like, cherish when you're not. Mm-hmm. Cherish when you can go to the grocery store. When you can live a normal life.
Yeah.
When you can have relationships with people and it's for the right reasons. And it's not just because like you want something out of me. I think that's probably a message you can understand better than almost anybody.
We just took a little commercial break.
And we're back.
Now we're back.
Now we're back.
To be legendary.
Do you ever watch Seinfeld?
Of course.
Okay. The Merv Griffin episode where Kramer brings like the studio set into his apartment and he's having like a talk show.
I don't remember specific episodes, but tell me about it.
So basically he brings this like, let's say you threw out the whole backdrop to Dare to be Legendary. I find it in a dumpster. I put it in my apartment and like you'd walk into my apartment and I'd be like, Blake, well, like basically like now anytime you go into his apartment, you're like on this talk show.
You're on the show.
And he'd be like, somebody'd be like, I'm leaving. Well, we'd love to have you back. And he'd be like, we'll be right back. And he'd play some music and he'd start munching. Like,
oh, that's so funny. Just sitting at home.
Yeah. It was a good episode.
Classic Seinfeld, man. The writing in that show, Larry David and Jerry.
Genius.
Unbelievable.
So good.
So many like little life moments that none of us blink about, but you're like, oh my God, that happened to me. And it's that's why I like Curb Your Enthusiasm too.
Yep.
Yeah.
Such a good show.
Yeah. Anyways, jumping back. So you become good friends with Drew and Alex. Their career skyrockets. And you go from sitting in coach, probably even like sharing hotel rooms.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
right?
Yeah. Like, oh, yeah.
Doing it really, really cheap to these guys being some of the biggest stars in the game. What was that experience like going from pretty much like just flying coach everywhere to the Jets, the glamour, the Grammys, all that good stuff?
I just found a video clip the other day. It's on my desktop now. We get on this plane and it must have been after Closer came out. And like, I'm in the front row, middle seat. Drew's in the second row, middle seat. Alex in the third row, middle seat. And it was just like, now every time they have a show in Vegas, like they're flying there private. And like, look at something of like, how things have just changed like completely night and day different. It's crazy. It's crazy to just see what can happen.
Right.
If you put in the time and the work.
Yeah. And they have some of the hardest working habits I've ever seen. They're constantly putting out music. They're constantly touring. They're constantly being social. And I think their image is like, oh, they're the party boys. What did you learn from those guys in the way they like relentlessly kept working? It's no secret why they made it to where they're at and why you made it to where you're at. You guys are always working, always putting in work. And I'm just curious, like, what lessons have you learned from them being around them so much?
That it takes a lot of discipline to, like, put out that kind of content and be able to, you know, like, despite finding success, like, even, like, when they were going through a phase of, like, everybody ripping them apart, like, other DJs, like, trashing on Closer, saying, like, you just hear, like, what you're saying earlier, like, people try to rip you down. And, like, to see them be able to, like, you know, put on blinders and still focus on what they want to do, I think it's very eye-opening and inspiring to see them continue to do what they want versus, like, despite how people can be negative in that.
Right. Can you relate to that at all, like, with your work?
Which part?
Where, like, you could get preoccupied with the judgment of it rather than saying, like, I know my vision, you don't.
Yeah.
You might be trying to rip me down, but...
Yeah, I mean, I think it definitely takes a toll on you, on your just mental game of, like, when people bash your work. Because it's not like, if anybody, like, disagrees with something I do, like, you know, they have the right to do that. But it's hard to sometimes... Like, sorry, the jet lag's kicking in.
You're good, bro.
It's hard to, when your intentions are good, and, like, when people still want to rip you down, and, like, about that, like, that's discouraging.
Right.
But I get it. I mean, everybody's entitled to their opinion.
Yeah. And when all that is going on, and they're making headlines, good and bad, you guys become a unit. And I'm sure your friendship becomes even stronger because not that it was you against the world, but you almost don't even know what's real and what's fake anymore.
Yeah. And
you guys were there at such an early stage that, like, that was pure. That was real.
Yeah. I mean, there was even times where, like, they were salty with me because, like, my career opportunities came up and I took those where it wasn't. They didn't think it was in their favor, or, like, where I was, like, going against them. Mm. And that's hard to do because you always had your own intentions and your own, like, ideas for your career.
Right.
But, like, being able to still show them that I, like, that I was still their boy and whatnot, like, I couldn't do it. I didn't do a tour with them because I had the Bieber job come up. And the Bieber job came up before I'd met them, but, like, it had just never gone through. Mm. And so I was just on this waiting game. So finally, by the time it came around, I was just like, hey, I can't do your tour. And they had every right to be upset with me. And so I was just like, look, like, my goal is to one day have a TV show. And I was like, this is the path I want to take because this is an opportunity for me to be able to show an artist that's of this caliber, this level, that people think this way. I want to show them for this. And during that time, I was able to turn Bieber onto Chainsmokers music, which in the long run...
Right.
You
brought him to a show, right?
Well, first turned him onto a song. He made a video of him dancing and rapping about stealing me from them, sent it to them. That goes viral for them when they post it. And then they did... He shouted them out on, like, Z100 in New York. And Drew was like, yo, did Bieber just shout us out? And, like, so then that helped him go to radio and then brought him to a show.
Wow.
And it was nice to be able to, like, it all happened organically. Like, Bieber saw my friends dancing to that song, wanted to know what it was. And
what song was it?
Roses. In a unreleased version of Don't Let Me Down. And so it was cool to be able to prove to them, like, I still had your back.
Right.
Like, this wasn't, like, if there was a way to do both, I would have. And I was able to still make it up to them and maybe in the long run was the better decision.
Wow. Yeah, and I'm sure those guys, after seeing you thrive and get to do what you did, were happy for you at the end of the day.
Yeah. Right?
Mm-hmm. And, you know, I've obviously seen the relationship you guys have. And the hardest part is, like, you, what you do is always about making other people happy. And that's why people want you on the tour. Justin, Drew, and Alex, your videos, you're really just trying to make others around you feel good. And so I'm curious if, like, at some point, that takes a toll.
Yeah. I remember one of my friends, she wrote me a letter. And she kind of, like, nailed on the head what I was going through. And I had never, like, kind of, like, shared it with anybody. And she was just saying, like, it must get pretty exhausting being everybody else's hype man. And, like, at times you'd need that energy returned to you. And I was just like, yeah, like, and I was literally running on fumes, and I didn't know how to basically to switch it up, to refuel myself. And then three months later, I was in a car wreck. And so, like, then that was where I was able to make some changes and start, like, focusing on myself.
So that car wreck, although it was near death, was a huge turning point.
Huge turning point. Like,
did you call rock bottom?
No. I'd say five months after that was, like, rock bottom. But, like, that was, like, very eye-opening in the sense of, I remember coming, like, I got a concussion. When I came out of the concussion and I started remembering what was happening, it was like almost like somebody had stopped life and put everything in front of you, and you could, it was just everything in black was bad. Like, it was just black and white of just, like, your life. Like, it was almost like your life flashed before your eyes, and it was just like, this is toxic, this is bad, this is good for you, wow, this is bad. And it was just simple, and it was not, like, hard to agree with those choices, right, and apply it to my life. Like, I knew drinking was bad for me, mm-hmm, and at that moment I was just like, done, haven't had a drop since.
Wow.
And before that, like, if you would have been like, hey, like, I'm gonna try not drinking for a week, would have been nearly impossible.
Yeah.
So it was crazy that, like, a moment like that showed me so much into my life, yeah, in a snap of the fingers. And it was like, it lasted probably, less than 5 seconds that I saw into this window, and then it was gone.
While this was happening, the car pretty much exploded, right?
No, it was just upside down, and I'm in this state of shock.
Or this is when you came out, when you were...
Oh, yeah. Okay. So I crawled out of the car, I don't remember that, and I'm just standing there, and, like, kind of like you, like, you know when you're in a dream and all of a sudden,
yeah,
you're in the dream? Like, that's what I thought was happening. I thought I was in a dream. And I just kind of came to, and I'm just like, what's going on here?
Shit.
And then it was just like, boom, everything in life made sense. Then it was gone. And somehow I remembered, like, bits and pieces of how I was supposed to find this peace in life. And, like, I was able to, like, apply some of those things. And I've seen huge changes or huge, yeah, benefits from that. But they all seemed so easy, I guess, because I was shown.
Right.
I don't know. It was a weird experience.
I see the transition. And a few years ago, we're hanging out and we were talking about always having to be on, always having to please everybody around me. And sometimes I just want to turn off. Sometimes I might not be in the mood. And I think that pressure for you, whether it be your friends, like, my friends want to go out, I can't let them down. My friends want me on this trip, I can't let them down. This fan wants to hang out with me, even though I feel like shit right now, and I probably don't want to talk to people, I feel the pressure to be Rory Kramer at all times. Now I see you in a place where, like, you've had the time to think about yourself. How do I keep myself healthy? Like, obviously, you know, you stop drinking. There's temptation all around you everywhere. Like, we're in Hollywood, LA. And to be able to say no to that like pick your battles, I think is, it shows your growth just in that short period of time. And I haven't heard like that whole part of the story as like such a turning point, but I have seen just your mindset and your transition go from like, I need to please everybody around me, and you were forgetting about Rory,
yeah,
to like, I'm strong enough to make my own decisions. And hopefully people understand, and I'm not letting them down, but at the end of the day, like, I have to make sure I'm taking care of me.
Yeah. Yeah, it was crazy. Like, the other week at my birthday, we went bowling. You were there. And after, I went to Jeremiah and Evan's place to catch a flight to Greece. And Jeremiah, he's just like, dude, that was crazy. Like, everybody, there's, he goes, like, 30 people will just raise up, like, glasses of a shot of tequila, and you're the only one not with one. And I was like, that's savage. And I was like, it's crazy to, like, just see how things change, or, I don't know.
Yeah, and I think it's smart. There's all these negatives that we bring into our life because, usually because we're trying to appease other people.
Mm-hmm.
Alcohol is one, actually, where, like, sometimes I drink it because it keeps me awake.
Yeah.
Otherwise, I'll fall asleep.
Exactly
which you were talking
you
about,
mean,
too, is like, sometimes I just get tired now.
Mm-hmm. I get tired.
But that's still not a reason to do it if, like, it's leading to bad things. I remember you're just talking about, like, the people at your birthday party. I remember the premiere, and you packed this double-story, what would you call that, building. Two-story building you packed for this premiere. I saw a bunch of like artists and celebrities, and I'm like, this guy has touched all these people. Like, does it ever just dawn on you, like, what you've done in your career and like that short amount of time?
It's crazy to look at the last 5 years, but to look at from the time on my 30th birthday when I like called my boss and was like, yo, here's my 2 weeks. And he's just like, good. Like,
yeah.
Glad you're like finally figured out how to utilize your talents. Cause that was like one of his goals, was to figure out how to utilize my talents in his company before somebody stole me. And by the time I'd quit, within 6 months, did the Avicii video, had a meeting with Bieber's team about being his dude, to having MTV within a year and a half, like green light a pilot. It was just like, right. Holy shit. Like, how much else have I been missing out on because I haven't said yes, or I haven't just taken the step and seen what happens, or being willing to fail?
Yeah. So I think it's cool too that your goal was always the TV show.
Yeah.
And so when you accomplish some of your goals, and actually I'm going through some of this myself where I didn't set big enough goals. And you hit them way faster than you thought you ever would. And you're like, well, shit. I didn't set big enough goals. Did you go through that as well?
Yeah. As soon as I had a TV show, it was just like, everybody's like, what's next? And I'm just like, I don't know. Like, that was it.
Right.
I guess I could go back to my fourth grade dream of being in the NFL and the NBA at the same
time.
There
you go.
No, like, it was just like one of those things of like, holy shit. Like, you actually can do those crazy things in your head that people think don't really happen to normal people.
Yeah.
I'm not different than anybody else. Maybe I am. but no, like, in the sense of like, you know, if you put in the time, you can do it.
Yeah.
And so now it's like, well, what's something next I want to do? What's something that has not just what I want to do, but like what has like actual meaning? What has substance of... If you look at the whole idea of life of you will die one day. After that wreck, it kind of like put things into perspective of like, that's going to happen. And so it's like, well, what I want to do with my time now that has substance.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, I haven't been working as much as I have on the scale of like the last 5 years, but now I've done that and I've kind of earned these relationships or whatever. Now I enjoy just the human connection, right, of being able to spend my time on what I please.
And you're back to your quote in the Avicii video, you're not chasing the money.
Right.
And once you stop trading your time for money, sure, maybe you don't have as much in your bank account. You're going to survive.
Mm-hmm.
You live in a one bedroom or two bedroom?
One bedroom
apartment. You're going to feed yourself. You're still going to live a great life. And that dialing back where you're not constantly on tour, or you're not constantly working, has allowed you to have the freedom to like think about yourself.
Well, I just look at like the last 5 years where it's just like I did a lot of jobs that there was sometimes I wish I could have spent with my family versus do the job. And making those steps in my career, those moves, didn't change my happiness any bit. And so now it's just like I still love to work hard and love what I do, but it's not going to control me in the sense of my decision making.
Yeah. So you realigned your values, which I currently I'm still trying to make a name for myself. And so sometimes the sacrifice.
You've done pretty well.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Working on it. I feel like we're both just getting started.
Yeah.
But in that, you make sacrifices. And your family is very understanding. My family is very understanding. But then when you look at it and you're like, at the end of the day, the most important thing to me is my family and a wife and kids playing catch on the beach with my son. But you're sacrificing some of the things that get you there sometimes.
Yeah.
It's kind of a wake-up call.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Yeah.
It's always just fascinating to me, like, what I've gotten to not only experience, but allow, like, friends or family to experience with me.
Parents have been to shows.
Parents have been in the green room with Ray Shrimmer when it's just basically hot boxed.
Yes.
Mom's just like, whew, can you get high on secondhand smoke? And they're like, yes, ma'am, you can. But no, it's just those are the moments that are like make it all worth it.
Yeah.
Where it's just like you get to give somebody else a peek behind the curtain.
It's so true. I had a great trip to Las Vegas, my 21st birthday. Went with a bunch of friends and my parents came. My sisters came. And to get them all there, like with my friends from college who they hadn't met, they saw me at a bar. I went up and did karaoke. It was like, I got the same feeling in my bar mitzvah. It was like friends and family. That is, and it's the best feeling in the world. When you're like, hey, mom and dad, you think I'm this, but have a peek into my life. There's nothing better.
Yeah, that's, have a peek into my life.
Welcome to Blake's world.
Right?
Welcome to Rory's world. Yeah.
I like Blake's world. It's pretty, your birthday was pretty, a pretty good one.
It's a good time. Actually, my dad's like, can I come? I was like, I don't know if you're gonna have fun at this. He would have enjoyed it, but it was just so crowded. You know, there's a lot of people there.
There was a lot of people.
Yeah. It was a good time.
It was a great time.
I love just getting the friends together. There's nothing like it.
That was like the ideal. It was like, I remember waking up that day and I'm getting texts from two different birthday parties. And it's just like, yo, like, let's go here. And it's just like, I know I already have to go here. Blake has set this up for a month. I've had the flyer, like, save the date. Here's these other group of friends that are like, please do not say you're going to the opposite side of town, because it's like, my day is going to be like, hey, what's up? Like, you make your way through all the people, say hi, be like, cool. And then you have to drive across town and do the same thing. And like, at the end of the day, your time's spread thin. You don't really enjoy either one.
Right.
And as I'm watching these two texts, it's like both parties are going to end up at the same place, share the same table. I'm like, victory.
Yes,
this is like, this is, the universe is aligning again.
Yeah,
that was a fun day.
Right. Which I didn't even know that all that was going on. You show up, which you did in Hawaii too. You flew from EDC to my birthday trip in Hawaii, which meant a lot to me. Gave a great speech when we.
That was fun.
Yeah, but anyways, I wanna talk about something that one of my favorite stories from you. You're like, you could write a book. Maybe that's the next thing. We write a book.
Dude, I've tried to start the book. It's going to be hard.
You might even speak it. Like, have someone just transcribe what you're saying.
Transcribe.
But one of my favorite stories, and it's related to your acting reel, because you do an impression of Rob Dyrdek, who you looked up to. And I love this story because it's so raw, and I think it's something we can all relate to. But you got really good at sign making. And you were trying to get Rob Dyrdek's attention.
Mm-hmm.
And so tell me about that story when you moved to LA.
25 years old, Fantasy Factory's on TV, on MTV. It's one of the like biggest shows. Like, I'm obsessed with it. And it was like the reason I was so obsessed with that show, not because it was just good and not because like I was into the same things as Rob. It was the first time I had seen someone basically build a brand. And not only was he he was a pro skater, but he had clothing lines, he had a TV show, he had all these things that are hubbed around him. Me at that time, like, I love making t-shirts, I love making videos, and I wanted to act. Like, how do I, like, which lane do I go in? Which, do I do them all at once? Should I focus on this? How do I grow? Like, I don't want to become you, but like, how do I have a little bit of something like that? And so when I got to LA, I'm from the Midwest where it's just like, you ask somebody a question, like, you know, they'll give you their time. So I'm like, yo, he's from Ohio. Like, I'm just going to go find out where he lives or knock on the door and get my answers right then and there. And off I go and start my own world. So I figure out where Fantasy Factory shot, and I strategically placed myself on a street corner at 8 a.m. because I followed him on Twitter, and I noticed the tweets at what time they started and that he gets to work at around 8 a.m. and that the show starts filming at noon. So there's a four-hour window that he does something at the offices. So he might have time. If he sees a sign, he might invite me in. So for 5 days in a row, I placed myself from 8 a.m. to noon with a sign that says, I'm not homeless, I'm just looking to network. 5 days in a row, everybody, like his manager, Drama, who now I'm like friends with, which is so funny. And like Rob drive by, they all drive by. And like, so then on the last day, Friday, everybody keeps driving by. This guy, his name was Tracy, stops, and he was like Rob's graphic designer, like did like his cartoons, his toy line. And he's just like, yo, like, what's up, man? Like, what are you out here for? And I'm like, real kind of like nervous, like, shit, like, what I say to this guy, like, my whole plan could fall into this guy. I'm just like, oh man, I'm just like trying to network and like being very, very vague, because I was like, Rob Dyrdek obviously is successful because he thinks a certain way. All these people work for him. I have no idea if Rob has sent them out to talk to me. I don't know if they're just gonna be like, yo, kid, beat it, like, you're wasting your time. If I'm going to get a no, I want it from Rob. Yeah. I don't want it from one of these guys. So I'm just like kind of vague about it. Another guy comes by, same question. Another guy comes by, same question. And so I'm just like, shit, like, here goes Rob buzzing right by. I'm like, shit, like, guess we're going to have to come back next Monday. And one of the guys comes back out and he's like, yo, so there's this party that some guys from the office are throwing. It's this Young and Reckless Diamond Supply collab for this t-shirt release. There's gonna be a lot of people that, you know, you could probably network, seems like, that you're into. You should, you know, come by that. So I go by. As soon as I get there, you have to sign a release because they're filming Fantasy Factory. I'm like, shit, Rob's gonna be here. So after a couple Coronas, and like Rob walks in and just the heart's pounding out of the chest, I find a small window where I'm just like, I was like, hey, Rob, like, you got a second? He's like, will you sell him, player? And I'm just like, oh, boy. I was like, what's a guy got to do to get a meeting with you? He's like, dude, three of my people stop and, like, ask you what you're doing on the street corner, and you act like you're not there to see me. And I'm like, he knows who I am. Oh, my God. Like, no. And so I'm just like, well, I go in my defense. I go, if I'm going to hear no, I want to hear it from you. So he's like, all right, I respect that. And now, like, Chanel West Coast is listening in. A couple other guys are listening in. They're like, and Rob's like, yo, man, this guy's like been coming to my house, like dropping off stacks of t-shirts with a letter saying like, this is what I could do to work for you. And they're like, yo, Rob, this kid hustled you, man. Like, he dropped it off and left. He wasn't waiting there. He's like, all right, you got a point. And so he was like, yo, I'll have you down sometime. Like, I'm a busy guy. I don't know when that'd be. Fast forward years.
Like, you don't have the meeting.
Don't have the meeting. Fast forward like 8 years, Chainsmokers are on Ridiculousness, and Alex is like, yo, I've already told the producers that our boy has a Rob Dyrdek impression. If they want to use you on the show, like, you're coming to the show, and if they don't use you, I just still have to see you do it to his face in the green room. And I'm like, cool. Is he going to remember me as that, like, weirdo fan? Kid. Yeah. So I brush up, get about 20 seconds of material ready, like, in case, like, I have to do it. And
do you remember it?
Yeah. So I'm, like, nervous. And I hadn't been this kind of nervous in a while. So, like, I'm sitting in the green room, and Alex just, like, we're, like, Alex is talking to me, but it's in one ear, out the other. I'm like, when's Rob coming in here? Like, shit. So the door opens, and it's, you just feel the energy of the door. And it's just like, he walks in. He's like, what's up, Drew? What's up, Alex? What's up, Rory? And I'm like, oh, my God. Like, he still remembers. He's like, my producers come in. They're like, yo, Chainsmokers boy's got this Rob impression. Like, their boy Rory's got this Rob impression. And I was like, wait, Chainsmoke, my Rory? Like, got the sign on the street with the rogue status with the arm motion going, yo, what's up? You got my, like, that Rory? And I'm like, he goes, now here you are, filming for the Chainsmokers. Like, what's been up? And I'm like, and before I could say anything, Alex's like, well, he's like Ben Bieber's like videographer for the last year. He's got he just sold a TV show. And he's like, what's the concept? Tell him the concept. He's like, what network? Tell him MTV. Mm. And he goes, fuck me.
Wow.
Literally was just like, did I miss like seeing this future? Like, because I didn't take up that meeting where I said I'd have you down.
Oh.
Maybe, what if I would have had that meeting? What if I had seen the next, you know, 7 years and saw that this end game? Could I have been a producer? Could I have like, so it's one of those things of just like, where I didn't get the meeting like initially, but I got the result that like what I had was real. And like this dream I had, like he might not have seen it. Other people might not have seen it at the time, but I believed in it enough. And over the course of time, I made it real. And I got the answers that I was looking for by doing my own time, just sticking to what I believed in, what I wanted, versus what somebody might have said in a meeting. And it was crazy. And he gave me his email after that, and he wrote me a real nice email about getting your show to be greenlit, and how he was like, yo, I've had a ton of friends, had straight-to-series shows, all canceled, and he was like, you must have done something right. He's like, you're the only show that hasn't been canceled yet, that's new. And then he gave me like a 45 minutes of his time one time on the phone. I just had some like advice on how you deal with executives at MTV.
Yeah.
And his advice was like, the more you can put your name on the show, the better. Mm. He goes, if it's something small, like the color of this sign, who gives a shit? Like, mm-hmm. The more you can stamp your name on it, the better. Like, don't sweat the small stuff. Just, you know, do it the best you can and put your name on it as more as you can. Mm. And yeah, so it was crazy to like, I don't know, just like have that like come to fruition. Because I remember like,
insane.
I'd gotten my friend Dexter a job at Young and Reckless. Like basically like—
Shout out Dexter.
Yeah, shout out Dexter. So basically drama, put a thing out looking for videographer, editor or something. And I knew because I had following and a blue check mark, I was like, if I DM this guy, maybe he'll see like, okay, this guy knows camera stuff. I'll take his word for it. So I sent him an email. I was like, yo, like my friend Dexter is looking for a job. Like, can I connect you? He's like, sure, do it. Dexter ends up doing this, works for him. And, he had me in to be on a couple, like, do, like, a podcast with him and, couple other things, like, for drama. Snapchat or drama. And Rob calls drama one day, and he's just like, yo, why are you hanging out with Rory, dude? And he's like, what do you mean? He's like, yo, it's Bieber's Rory. Like, and he's like, sign Rory. Like, and he's like, what?
What?
And he's like, that's when like Drama was like, yo, I want to have you on my podcast. He was like, you were one of the only people. He's like, we were getting people all the time doing crazy shit like that. He was like, when we were on TV, it was like crazy. Mm-hmm. But he goes, you were the only one that like came down there looking for something and still went out and did it, regardless of our help or what we said. Like, you still went out. And he was like, that was crazy. And
it's amazing. Yeah. What I love about that story is relating to what you just said from Drama. I think sometimes you're looking for the right people to propel you into where you're going, which no doubt, like, you've had people around you, just like you've helped your friends build their brand. You've definitely had people who've helped propel you. But a lot of people will take the negative of like, my idol doesn't think I'm cool or didn't give me the time of day, and that can crush people. Mm-hmm. But you said, I'm Rory Kramer, and you didn't even blink an eye. Like, you went on your own path. And that's why that story is so incredible, because you didn't let it crumble you. The fact that like you had this moment with the guy you looked up to most, and it's almost like you completely like forgot about it and now listen to this story.
Yeah.
That in itself is a book.
I have it in one of my journals.
Yeah.
Like the full, just all written out. It was like mind-blowing at that time where I was just like, where I went to that party and like so much happened that night. Like, another part of the story that's like crazy was I had this watch on. And another guy at the party, a couple of people were like, yo, nice watch. Little did I know that the person that made this watch met with Rob earlier that week about partnering with him with these watches. I bought this watch at a random place, this t-shirt store in Orlando, Florida, my last day living down there. And at the party, I don't know anybody. I see a guy with the same watch as me, and I go, yo, nice watch. And this guy's like, his thought is in his mind, where the fuck this kid get this watch?
Yeah.
He messages his manager, and like, I gave him my business card, like, just like, hey man, like, you know, like, you seem like a cool dude. Obviously, we have the same watch. Like, maybe we'll, who knows, maybe we're into the same stuff. Like, later that night, I get a call from this guy, like, yo, who are you? And like, are you about to mess up this watch deal? And like, so like, Rob saw the watch on me, and like, it was all just like, it was too weird of a story.
I don't know what you want to call that, fate or just life playing itself out, but it's weird to like hear all this stuff.
Cause like then Rob's thinking like, was I working with these guys? Like, it was just so bizarre that
almost also like the moment where Drew and Alex give you the spotlight. And you're like, I'm going to take this moment and climb up. So in that moment, you didn't take it, but you planted a seed. And I talk to people all the time. Like, a lot of people plant a seed and they want it to sprout overnight. Even with you, when I first met you, I had nothing. Like, you're like, who is this kid? Everybody wants my time. Like, I had nothing to offer you. I knew that seed would eventually sprout. Like, all we needed to do was hang out and talk. And like, you'd understand me better. I'd understand you better. And I was looking forward to that day, even though from the first time I met you, which was like Red Rocks, till we went on that hike, it was probably like a year and a half.
Right.
About a year and a half. And the same thing with Rob. Like, you planted a seed, but you were like, oh, this seed didn't sprout immediately. So my life's over. I'm going to go be an accountant. And that when that plant grew, like, it was the most beautiful tree that you could possibly grow.
It's crazy. Yeah. And that seed almost got squashed or whatever you want to call it, plucked out. I was supposed to do an episode of Fantasy Factory. Like, the producers found my YouTube videos and were like, they wanted to have this. And I'd found out when we did Ridiculousness, Rob was like, yo, you remember you were supposed to be on an episode? I was like, yeah. I was like, the super fan episodes? He was like, it was supposed to be about like these stalker fans. And I was just like, there's something about this kid. We can't do that to him. So
no
I had it killed.
Way. And you would have done it.
Of course. I'd already signed my life away to like be on the show and impersonate him. And like, he killed it. And so
he
he was just like, there's something about this guy that's not really stalker-like. Like, there's something in that conversation where I had an exchange with him that one night where he must have been like, this kid is really trying to do something where he's not just trying to meet me and like, because I'm famous.
Right. I mean, I'm curious about this. It sounds like there's a trend or a commonality where you don't necessarily get all that nervous in those moments, even though you probably were.
Like, I was like crying at the end of the night. Like, cause I was like, I blew it.
Right. You blew it. You feel like you blew it. But in that moment, you were probably still, like, it sounded like you were pretty calm, like with your responses. And it's in those moments, like, you only have like a few sentences to say to someone like Rob. You don't want to fuck it up. So, like, is it crazy to now see kids who come up to you and kind of have that same
It's so bizarre, dude. Yeah. It's just gratifying to see, like, how the tables have turned. And it's just like, oh, wow. Like, I'm Rob Dyrdek in this situation now. And, like, you have to catch yourself, flip the switch and be on for them and be able to, you know, with your little bit of time, how can you give them the wisdom that they might be looking for?
Is that something you've asked Rob?
No.
Because I feel like he's such a cool guy.
Dude, I think he's just on another level where he's been. I think when you're in it so long that you just condition your mind and your life to be part robotic in a sense of, like, let's say you do 100, 1,000 of these shows. You're just going to be on. You're going to be firing every time. You're going to be getting better. I think once you just build up momentum, the compound effect over and over, that is just. I remember I did like a web series, and like this girl that was really well known on it, like she got a photo with everybody on the cast, and every photo looked the exact same because she's done it so much. It's just routine. And I think it's something like that.
It's interesting. It's almost like becomes second nature.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. Well, I definitely think you should write a book. It's an audio book that you're narrating. But I'm curious what else you got going on that you want to share, where people can find you. Like, what can we plug here for people to learn more and see more from Rory Kramer?
You can find me at 1-1's. I'm just kidding. I was going to give my address.
Wouldn't be surprised.
Yeah, that would be funny. You can find me, you know, YouTube, Twitter, Instagram, all those just at Rory Kramer. Mm. I got this collab I'm working on with my clothes that I'm like really excited about. There's this company called Tyranny and Mutation out of New York. It's where I get all my band tees from like the 90s. Mm. Just like when I bought my first couple shirts from him, he sent like a handwritten letter, and just the attention to detail that he like paid and like what he was observant about and like knew the things I like, the lengths of the shirts I was looking for, what bands. So he was like just very like, you could tell he wasn't into it because like band t-shirts were trendy and you can make a lot of money off of it. He literally loved like that era of music, as did I. And so like just over time, I was like always wanting to just like help him out, like, cause I had a following. And so like I'd always tag him in when I got new shirts. And I was just like, hey, I'd love to collab with you. And he was like, yeah, what are you thinking? And it was, I just got into doing this kind of like art/merch thing called 1980 Bones,
mm-hmm.
where it's like these skeleton paintings I've been doing. And so one of the drawings—
Still owe me one.
I'll get you. Well, I'll probably get you one of the shirts. I don't have my phone.
Good.
But he just sent me like a picture, like the mock-up, and the shirts are all printed on black blank shirts from the 90s. So it's got like this just like vintage feel, and it's, I don't know, I'm just like super like excited about it because it's something where you just like everybody like paid attention to the detail and like tried to get it as true to as an era of in time as it could be. So it was a fun little like side project that's like, I got like an order of 50 shirts, gonna give away 25 to like friends and then sell another 25 and not be about like trying to make money, but just like just trying to make something cool, something unique.
You always have shirts where I'm like, where did he get that? Like sometimes, you know, you see in LA at like the swap meets and stuff, like you always have like unique stuff that you're not going to see at like Zara.
Yep.
Right.
I was debating on what to wear today.
You told me. I thought we were going to coordinate.
I know. I almost
wasn't
wore,
meant to be, I guess.
I was going to wear my fringe jacket with no shirt.
That would be fun. Next time. Episode two.
Wow. That would have been for my own Wilson. But, no. I'm always fascinated to jump down rabbit holes with you.
Yeah, it's fun, man. So I want to get to like one or two more things. Like if you could go back
and redo this? Yeah, I would. I'd do it on a I wish I wasn't so jet lagged so I could be firing on all cylinders.
There's an episode two and I actually had the thought this week. I think me and you in front of a live audience.
Dude, that would be sick.
That would be fun. So
are these other questions?
If you could go back and give 25-year-old Rory any bit of advice, what would it be?
Be nicer to yourself. Be nicer to others.
It's a good one, plain and simple.
Yeah.
Cool, man. We'll wrap up here. Any last words?
I do not regret the things I've done, but those I did not do. But if I hurt you along the way, I'm sorry. And I hope to make it up to you.
My brother. Dude, appreciate you.
Thank you for your time.
You're a great friend. You're a great man. Thank you so much for just always being there for me, having my back. This was really fun. I'm sitting here like kind of the Rob Dyrdek story, but much, much smaller scale. When I initially reached out to you, to think that I get to sit here and chop it up with you for a few hours like that.
You're the first person to like give me something free off of like because based off of my skill set, two movement watches. Like,
yeah.
I remember that.
I saw that Lake Life video. I want to go back and look at the DM, but yeah, man, you inspire me and then getting to travel with you and do fun stuff. Like it's been awesome and I appreciate you.
Yeah, I appreciate you too, man. You're a very unique person that brings out the best in people. And every time your name's brought up, there's nothing but either smiles or just funny, good things to say about you. And like that's, you know, it's kind of like, those are the kind of things like, not that I envy, but like I hope one day like people say about me versus like, yeah, yeah. But
I think you have plenty of
that. That's the mentality I want to carry.
Yeah.
Is like when people speak of my name, they like speak like that, the way they do you.
Legacy, thank you, my man. I appreciate you. We're just getting started.
Legendary,
I know you've
man.
Achieved all of your dreams, but we're just getting started, baby.
Just getting started. Yeah. Dare to be legendary.
You heard it first.
Yeah.
All right, that was fun.